Not us last time.
Have your roll. Got it.
Yeah, like you're speaking here, but you're right in front of. Yeah, and then you're done. Yeah, so that you're right in front of, you're talking, that's what does that mean? Oh, I don't know why, yeah, so it's just.
We'll give it another shot.
Okay.
When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place.
Suddenly the sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting.
I'll tell you.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, okay, we're good. Mike. Good morning, we'll keep going. Good morning, Lisa Falvo on the mic. Okay, I have the privilege of standing up here this morning to tell you about my steps journey. Keep going, okay. Oh, thumbs, we're good.
Testing, good morning. Testing 1, 2, 3. That sounds pretty good. How you doing? Welcome, Bobbleyays. Hello, Aki. Oh, look, Hannah Carney, how are you this morning? We got Will. Man, how are you? Sound good? We're going to go, yeah.
First.
Thank you.
When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place.
Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting.
All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them.
Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven.
When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard them speaking
in his own language.
John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life.
Johannes 3:16. Want so lief het God die wereld gehad, dat hy sy enige gebore seun gegee, so dat elkeen wat in hom glo nie verlore mag gaan nie, maar die ewige lewe kan
hê. Tal manera amó Dios al mundo, que ha dado a su Hijo unigénito, para que todo aquel que en él cree, no se pierda, mas tenga vida eterna.
Car Dieu a tant aimé le monde, qu'il a donné son Fils unique, afin que quiconque croit en lui, ne périra point.
Want also lief heeft God de wereld gehad, dat hij zijn enige geboren zoon gegeven heeft, opdat een ieder die in hem gelooft, niet verloren gaat, maar eeuwig leven heeft.
Also hat Gott die Welt geliebt, dass er seinen eingeborenen Sohn gab, und dass alle, die an ihn glauben, nicht verloren werden, sondern dass
er... Jumala maailmaa rakastella, että hän antoi ainokaisen poikansa, ettei yksikään, joka hänen uskonut, vaan sinä olisi ihan kaikkein elänyt.
John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life.
Please join me in prayer. Your Spirit, God, works in our weakness until we are aflame with your love and power. Fill the hearts of your faithful with living fire, that we may set the whole world ablaze. Through Jesus Christ, to whom with you and the Spirit be honor and praise, now and forever. Amen. Congregation, please stand as we sing together 228.
welcome to the worship of the Lord. Welcome to this Pentecost Sunday, this day when we celebrate and rejoice in the coming of the Holy Spirit on the church. Here at the Rochester Christian Reformed Church, we seek to welcome folks in, we seek to build them up, and then we seek to reach out as a congregation into our communities with the hands of Christ's mercy and with the good news of his gospel. This morning, as we gather in this sanctuary, I want to give thanks to those who help hang the beautiful banners which align the walls of our sanctuary and make this place feel like the royal home of our God. This is his house, and he greets us this morning, so receive the greeting of the Lord this morning, people of God. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, and this morning, especially the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said, Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
In his conversation with Nicodemus, the Pharisee, Jesus said, Very truly, I'll tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit.
The Holy Spirit is also one who convicts us of sin and leads us into all righteousness. Let us now confess our sins to God, trusting Christ as our Savior and Lord. Come, Holy Spirit.
Illuminate the places in our hearts
that have been choked by the cares of this world. We give you our tithes, our sin, our struggles with empathy. In your mercy, cleanse us.
We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hear now the assurance of pardon from Romans 8, 1 through 2 and 11. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Jesus Christ, the law of the Spirit of life set us free from the law of sin and death.
And if the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in us, God who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to our mortal bodies through the Spirit who lives in us.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I have the privilege of standing up here this morning to tell you about my steps journey. Initially, I was hesitant about participating in the program. I had understood we were to choose an area of focus, perhaps a struggle, and work towards finding freedom from these unhelpful patterns through scripture, exercises, and reflections. I was certain I didn't have the time. Being busy with my family, the kids' activities, and work, I couldn't see myself taking on anything else. These reasons to not participate seemed valid and concrete, yet I felt this pull to join the introductory steps meeting and learn more. And I'm so glad I did, because this has been a spiritual transformation that I never imagined could happen to me. The first exercise helped me to recognize the behavior I wanted to work on.
I had spent too much power to a destructive pattern, and I was spent. While the thought of opening up in a group setting made me nervous, and I knew looking inward was going to be awkward, I was hopeful and ready to trust the process. But it was so much more than just trusting the process. It was trusting God, and it was having the courage to engage with him for direction and light where there had been darkness. It was listening to his will. It was surrendering and letting go. It was challenging sometimes, revealing most times, and ultimately rewarding. I felt encouraged knowing I wasn't alone in this journey and free of judgment. My steps group consisted of women who listened, shared, and inspired me to continue to connect with God, which is something I never would have done on my own. I began to realize that I was replacing unhelpful behaviors with helpful ones because of the different exercises and reflections we had worked on each week. We just finished our final week, and I'm so thankful for this journey. With the help of God, the steps process has replaced my powerlessness with strength, my fear with courage, and I have the tools to rely on when I find myself struggling. I pray that my story will resonate with someone and give you the courage to follow God's will and find your freedom. No matter how intimidating or how uncomfortable your struggles may be, God loves you and he will walk with you as he did with me. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa, for sharing. This morning, Lisa was sharing about the STEPS program. As you know, Julie Elliott has been helping to lead that and introduce that in the life of our congregation, and several of you took part in that, and you'll be hearing another testimony later of that work. It's suitable and appropriate for this day of when we celebrate the work of the Holy Spirit, who leads us in the truth, who changes us. We also hope to offer another opportunity to do that in the fall. So if you are interested, please do reach out to Julie to indicate that interest, or reach out to me, and I'll make sure she's aware of that. But it's a great opportunity to grow. And now I'd like to, speaking of growth, I'd like to welcome our children to come forward for the children's message. Come on down. And I have to talk softer because the mask makes me sound really loud. How are you all doing today? So good to see you. So today is the day of Pentecost. That's kind of weird, right? Do you know what that means? It's a weird type of thing. But you know what Easter is, right? Yeah, Easter. We all like that. That's a big celebration of Jesus' resurrection. Hey, Tommy, how's it going? And but something happened 40 days after Easter. It's called the Ascension. We don't talk about that as much, but that's when Jesus, who had just come back to his disciples in the resurrection, he then ascended into heaven. He went away again. And that was really hard for the disciples. They were feeling bad. But Jesus said, don't worry. I have a gift for you. I have a gift I want to give to you, but you have to wait. Wait. Don't go anywhere. Wait for it. Now, if you're like me, you like getting gifts at Christmas. But Jesus gave them a gift like this. And he said, don't open till Pentecost. All right? Now, what was that gift? It was the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, I'd like to show you the Holy Spirit and be able to pull it out of this bag, but I can't, right? Because the Spirit, you can't see. So what happened on the day of Pentecost were that there were signs that the Spirit was present. That's what God did to help give confidence. And one of the signs was this. You know what this is? It's not mine, by the way. By the way, this my wife has a super-powered one. This thing has like, it's like a cord you'd find on a refrigerator or something. It's got this very... I'm going to get in trouble. Ken, I might need that extra room. Okay, so yeah, this is a hairdryer. Okay, I don't need it because I don't have much up there. But the it blows out a powerful wind. And on the day of Pentecost, there came a sound like a violent wind. Now, some people say it's not really wind. It's a sound of a wind, but it is connected to wind. There was this powerful sense of prayer. I wish it was a windy day so you could hear that. You know when the wind really whips? That was this sound of the Spirit coming, the sound of wind. Then there was something else. Then there was fire. Don't play with fire. Don't play with matches. I'm going to light a match in the church, which is probably a violation of our insurance policy, but let's do it anyways. Now, you see this little flame? It kind of looks like a tongue, doesn't it? And on the day of Pentecost, there were tongues like fire, as of fire that came to rest. We think it's on each of them, it says in the scripture. So we think it's above their heads. That's how it's often portrayed in art. Flame. There was fire. So we had wind. I had to blow this out. But we also had fire. And then something else happened. Oh, my microphone's on the outside. The other thing that happened, we had wind, we had fire, and then people started talking in different languages. Do you see that video of all the different languages all speaking together? That's what happened. And so on the day of Pentecost, there was also a gift of what we call tongues or languages. So I got these little mouths here. These are pretty cool, aren't they? Yeah. Now, we have wind, we have fire, and we have tongues. Now, what I want you to do is to ask your parents, because in the sermon, I'm going to explain what all those three signs mean. What I want you to do is quiz your parents. Go home and say, hey, Mom, hey, Dad, what was that hair dryer? What was that wind? What did it mean? What about that flame? What does that tell us? And what about those languages or tongues? What did they tell us? That's what I want you to do. Now, before I pray, I do have some extra of these. Now, you can't play with these in church, okay? So I'm doing this under some level of, if you'd like one, they're individually wrapped. Would you like one? No? Does anybody like one? Well, if you'd like one, I'm going to leave them here in this bag, and they're going to be in the back of the church. So if you'd like one, you go and get those after the service. That's probably a better idea. Or come see me, and I'll give you one, okay? Let me pray with you. Lord God, I thank you for each one of these little lives. I thank you that they have been called to be near you, and that your Spirit is in them, and that you love them. And Lord, I pray that you would help them to grow, as you help each and every one of us to grow in our faith. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You can go back to your seats or children and worship. And I appreciate your attentiveness this morning. And come see me if you want a little crazy critter. I'll make sure I don't set the church on fire here. Okay. All right. Now, would you now join me as I lead us in a prayer of illumination this morning? Spirit of God, we do pray that you would breathe on us, that you would fill us, that you would lead us into all truth. Reveal yourself to us this morning in the words of Holy Scripture. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. Hear now the word of the Lord. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem, and at this sound the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all of these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.' This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." You're a shining star, no matter who you are, shining bright to see what you could truly be. Those lyrics are from the 1970s band Earth, Wind, and Fire. It was their only number one single. It was the song Shining Star. And of course, the title of the sermon this morning, as you can see, is from the title of that band, Earth, Wind, and Fire. And on this Pentecost Sunday morning, I want you to see these three themes of Pentecost, as I talked about with the children, these three themes of earth, wind, and fire, and what they mean. And what I want you to really see is how vitally important the person of the Holy Spirit is to the vitality of our individual faith as Christians, and the vitality of the church as a whole. How much we need the Holy Spirit in our lives and in our church. So let's look at these three themes of Pentecost. The first one is the theme of earth. And that comes from verses 4 through 13, the end part of the text. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language?" And then in verses 9 through 11, there is the list of all of those nations, and it concludes with them being amazed that they were hearing about God speaking about God's deeds of power in their own language, and all were perplexed and amazed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" That's a really good question. What does this mean? What did those languages on the day of Pentecost mean? Why was that a sign of the coming of the Spirit? What does it mean, the speaking in other languages, other tongues? What is it about? Well, as you can tell from the outline, I'm suggesting it's about the earth. It's about the entire world. Now, many mistakenly take these languages that were spoken on the day of Pentecost and they treat them as if they were some type of heavenly language or some type of angelic language, some language not known to humanity. But that's a gross misinterpretation of the text. The languages spoken on the day of Pentecost, those referenced here, are languages of people of the earth. This text is about the earth. And it also goes back all the way to the Old Testament, to the Tower of Babel. Do you remember what happened at the Tower of Babel? How humanity was growing in its wickedness and its pride and built this tower, this edifice to their own pride. And then God decided to come down. And what did he do when he came down? Verse 7 through 9 of Genesis 11. "Come, let us go down." This is the divine counsel. "Come, let us go down and confuse their language there, so that they will not understand one another's speech." So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore, it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the earth. But here on this day, on the day of the Spirit's coming, on the day of Pentecost, there was a reversal of that curse of Babel. The Spirit of God came and untangled the languages of the world. Let me show you here on this map. Take a look at this map. I realize that might be hard to see exactly, but Jerusalem is that dot in the center there, right there. And all of those lines of the nations around, those ones that are in all caps, these are the nations that are listed in Acts 2, 9 through 11. Nations, and you can see the circular pattern. You can see how they were representative of the entire earth, at least as they knew it at that time. This was meant to convey a worldwide event, an untangling of the languages of the world. And you can go around in that circle and find every nation listed here. Thank you for that map, guys. You can take that down. The Jews gathered in Jerusalem on that day of Pentecost were symbolic of something worldwide. They were a microcosm
of God revealing to us that that plan of God, that the gospel would start in Jerusalem and go to Judea and Samaria, and as it says in the book of Acts, to the very ends of the earth. The good news would be spoken to all in their own language. John Polhill, in his commentary, writes, "The worldwide scope of the Christian witness is anticipated at Pentecost in the roll call of nations. To be sure, it was a question only of Jews and Jewish proselytes at this point, but they were diaspora Jews, represented every nation under heaven," verse 5. Already, the national barrier had been overcome, the racial barriers would be overcome, and the gospel would be shared with every people under heaven. Pentecost foreshadowed the worldwide mission. It was about the earth. The good news coming to all the earth. It was the day of Pentecost was like an impact crater where the Spirit came and sent ripples throughout the world. This is what's going to happen. It's like when you throw a rock into a pond and the ripples break out in concentric circles. This was the promise, and it was a promise to the earth. The promise of Habakkuk 2:14, I should say, "But the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea." Pentecost was about the earth. So when your children ask you about those languages, what were they about? What were those tongues about? They were about the love of God for the world. That's what Pentecost is about. It's about God so loving the world that he sent his Spirit to convey the message of the Son, the good news of the gospel to the entire earth. It's about the earth. The second theme of Pentecost is the wind. Is the wind. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. What does this sign mean for the people of God? What does wind signify in the Bible if we look at the Scriptures? Well, it signifies new creation. It signifies life. It signifies both physical creation and physical life and spiritual creation and spiritual life. The very beginning of the Scriptures, we read, "In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was formless and void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters." A wind from God, there at the beginning of creation, the wind of God comes. Many translations render that the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. You see, in the Bible, that word for wind, ruach, that Hebrew word, it can be translated as spirit, it can be translated as wind, it can be translated as breath. And so too, the word in the New Testament, the Greek word pneuma, can be translated as wind and as breath and as spirit. They all share this semantic range. When the Spirit comes, it is like the wind blowing, bringing new life, bringing new creation. Genesis 2:7, "And the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life," the ruach of life, "and the man became a living being." God breathed into the nostrils of humanity and life came forth. As Paul said at Athens, God himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. Wind is a sign of life. And not just physical life, and not just physical creation, but spiritual life, spiritual renewal. That's what this STEPS program is all about, is about seeking that spiritual vitality and life. And the Spirit brings that, the wind of the Spirit. We see this in Ezekiel's prophecy. In chapter 37, there is that great prophetic imagery of the valley of dry bones, these dead, dry bones having no life, representing the old covenant church. And then Ezekiel prophesies what will happen, this returning of life. And it comes through the power of wind, through the power of breath,
through the power of the Spirit. Ezekiel 37, verse 9, then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain that they may live. The wind, the breath of God coming to bring new life. A picture of a revived church. And those dry bones, they came together and they lived and they moved and they had being and vitality and revival came to the church. That's the hope and the promise of the day of Pentecost. It is the fulfillment of what Ezekiel said in Ezekiel 36, 27. I will put my spirit within you and make you follow my statutes and be careful to observe my ordinances. And on the day of Pentecost, that was fulfilled. As the Spirit came, that breath of God came to revive and create the new covenant church, to bring spiritual vitality and boldness. Jesus, in John 20:22, gave a forecast of the day of Pentecost. And it records there, when he said this, he breathed on them, his disciples, and said, receive the Holy Spirit. And on the day of Pentecost, the risen Lord Christ breathed into the nostrils of his church as he breathed into Adam new life and vitality. And the church came alive in boldness of witness, boldness of life. As Dennis Johnson puts it, the sound of the wind signaled the arrival of the Spirit who makes the dead alive. Pentecost was a new creation of a new covenant church. When your children ask you what that wind was about, the wind of Pentecost, it was about the coming of creation, a new creation of new life and new vitality. Earth, wind, and finally and thirdly this morning, fire. The third theme of Pentecost is fire. Verse 3, divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. What does that sign mean? What does the sign of fire signify in the Bible? Well, there's a variety of things. It could be judgment, it could be cleansing, it can be refining, but most often when it comes to the people of God, what the fire represents is God's presence with his people, his promise to be with us. And you see this over and over again in the Scriptures. Abraham, who was given that covenant promise, who left all that he knew in times of doubt, when he wasn't sure whether these promises were true, God had him do that ceremony where he cut the animals in half. He did this covenant-making ceremony, and God himself appeared in the form of a flaming torch and a smoking fire pot. He appeared as fire to say to Abraham in his doubt, I am with you. I am the God who is with you. Moses, when he was in the wilderness, when he was lost himself, when he was filled with doubt, he met the Lord in a burning bush, right? In the flames of fire out of a bush that did not consume the bush. God made his presence known in that theophany. I am with you, Moses. And he did it through fire. Israel, during the time of their wilderness wandering, as they were lost, as they were filled with doubt, God confirmed his presence that he would guide them and protect them through that pillar of fire at night to guide them on their way. That same pillar of fire that came to rest upon the tabernacle to remind them that God is with them. And on the day of Pentecost, as the church was reeling from the loss of the ascended Lord Jesus, when this nascent little church was really filled with doubt and confusion and uncertainty, God came in the person of the Holy Spirit. He came in fire to remind them that he is present with them. And this time, in the glory of the new covenant, everyone, the fire rests on each of them. Each believer is a little mini tabernacle, and the presence of God comes in the new covenant promise to dwell in us and with us. It is a fulfillment of what Jesus promised in John 14:18.
I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. And he came to them on the day of Pentecost with the Spirit of fire. So when your children ask you what was the fire of Pentecost about, it was about God's promise never to leave us nor forsake us, that he was with us and he would be with us until the very end of the age. Earth, wind, and fire. It is through the ministry of the Holy Spirit that the church is able to fulfill the great commission to go into all the world and to preach the gospel to every nation, every ethnos. It is through the ministry of the Holy Spirit that we are born anew like the wind of creation. The Spirit comes to hover over us, to bring new life to that which is spiritually dead, to breathe the Spirit of God into our nostrils so that we can embrace the gospel, the good news. And then he comes to dead churches. He comes to dry places and dry bones, and he makes that which is dead alive again. He brings new life by counseling us and convicting us and leading us into all truth, by sanctifying us, as we heard about these steps, this calling to newness of life. And finally, it is through the ministry of the Holy Spirit that we become the temple of the living God, that the fire of God's presence comes to live and reside in us, and we are counseled and comforted by his abiding presence. We know that we are not alone, but that God is with us. Do you see the glory of the Holy Spirit? Do you see the glory of the Spirit of the Lord? Beloved, without him, there is no life. There is no life in the church. There is no life in us. You've all heard by now of the Colonial Pipeline. That pipeline that was shut down by ransomware. That pipeline that brought so much gas to the eastern seaboard. And you saw people waiting in lines and running out of that fuel. And it was reminiscent in some ways of the gas lines of the 70s. But because that was shut down, those things, those cars, you couldn't go anywhere. That's an illustration of what the Holy Spirit is like in our lives and in the lives of the church. Without him, he is the pipeline of spiritual vitality in our lives. And if we do not seek him, if we do not yearn for him, and if we do not rely on him, we are going nowhere as a church. We are going nowhere in the Christian life. But if we yearn for him and hunger for him and seek him in our lives and for our church, then comes life. Then comes the breath of God. Then comes vitality and verdancy and a church that follows the Lord and people who call upon the name of the Lord. He is the Spirit of life, love, and the presence of God. He is the Spirit of earth, wind, and fire. So let us praise him. Let us praise the Holy Spirit. Won't you join me this morning as we praise him in song this morning? Let us join together in singing this hymn of praise to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, living breath of God, number 746. Would you rise and let us pray and sing together to the Holy Spirit?
For your purity, Holy Spirit. Hello, I want to thank everybody for their prayers, their cards, and I want to talk about the STEPS program. I just am in the final stages of taking the 12-step program, and all I can tell you, I want to thank Julie Elliott. She is the one that encouraged me to take this because I asked one question. The question is, who should take this program? She said, everybody in our church should be taking this program. I said, well, sign me up. And I did. And I have to tell you, it is a good time to understand myself in a more deeper, personal way. You have 12 weeks to really look at yourself on the areas that you want to work on. And you also get a better chance of who understanding who you are. It's in parallel. You get to have an opportunity to find out how much we can trust God to help us in our time of need. And it also brings up one other component, how important our friends, neighbors, and our family is during any time that we are walking through a deep valley. So I want to encourage everybody to consider looking at this course, talk to Julie Elliott, talk to anybody that's taken it, but you can also talk to me. I'd be happy to tell you more, but I want to thank you for considering this, and please enjoy taking the 12-step program, and blessings to all of you.
And Leo, for being willing to share that testimony with us on this particular day when we celebrate the work of the Spirit in our lives. Would you join me now in a Pentecost prayer? Join your hearts with mine. O breath of life, on this Pentecost Sunday, we ask that you breathe on us once again. Bring us new life. Revive us. We hunger for the life-changing power that you bring to us. These have been hard days for the church. We have been scattered. We've had our own diaspora, and we're still there. But you can bring life. You can bring things together. You can bring renewal. You can make us live. Lord, I pray that as we would look back in the future, on this time, that we would see that from it came new life and new ways for this congregation. And may our lives exemplify your fruit each and every day. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. O Spirit of God, may we use the gifts you have distributed to bless the church, to build your kingdom on earth, to all the earth, to every nation and tongue and tribe. O cleansing fire, change our lives, just as you did with the lives of the disciples on the day of Pentecost. May your burning fire refine and renew us. May we move in your power, and may our lives and ministries be infused with your divine authority and direction. Make us hunger, Lord. O Spirit, make us hunger and thirst for righteousness. Those of us who think we know everything, humble us and teach us new things. For those of us who think we have it all figured out, convict us and show us how we are wrong and how we need to change. And for those who are weak, for those who are burdened and heavy laden, come into their lives. Assure them of your presence. Assure them that the yoke of Christ is easy and his burden is light. Show them your grace and forgiveness. O Holy Spirit, O God of wind and fire, we celebrate today your indwelling, your abiding in us, your comforting presence. We thank you for the transforming work in our lives and through our lives towards others. Use us. Use us as light and life to others. Give us boldness as a congregation to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ with our mouths and with the hands of Christ's mercy through our giving and our outreach. May we share the good news. May we exude good deeds. Remind us to rely on you and your power to do the work you have given us. Use us, O Spirit of God, as your instruments, so that the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Praise be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, one God, over all, forever. Amen.
Our offertory scripture for this Pentecost Sunday is from 1 Corinthians 6, verses 19 and 20. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. Would you please join me in prayer? O God of earth, wind, word, and fire, we bless your name for sending the light and strength and life of your Holy Spirit. We give you thanks for all the gifts, great and small, that have been poured out upon us, your children. Accept us with our gifts all to be living praise and witness to you and to your love throughout the earth, through Jesus Christ, who lives with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever. Amen. Would you please stand for our closing song? We receive your blessing, and it's number 947.
Thank you. Praise Father, Son, and praise the Holy Ghost. We receive your blessing, we receive your grace as we walk in the light shining from your face. May the peace that you give change the way that we live. We receive your blessing as we leave this place.
Received God's blessing while you've been in this place together from the glorious presence of the Holy Spirit among us. He is wonderful, is he not? Amen.
Amen.
Glory be to the Spirit. Glory to be God, the Father, and the Son. It's great to be together to worship our triune God. As you go today, you go with the Lord's blessing. Thank you, Chrissy, for lifting us in song. Thank you for all of those who helped to make this possible. Thank you for that video, Gary, you put together. And for all those who spoke in tongues this morning at the Reformed Christian, at the Rochester Reformed Christian Church, doesn't happen to us very often, so, but we had speaking in tongues this morning in our church, so it's wonderful. When you, after I pronounce the blessing, please be seated. We will dismiss folks. I just want you to know, if you want to, we're going to dismiss this side first. You can exit right out the sanctuary. The doors are open in the fellowship hall. If you'd like to avoid a crowd or whatever, you can walk right back through the doors of the fellowship hall. There is coffee outside in the courtyard if you'd like to partake again on a beautiful Sunday morning. So, but for now, receive the blessing of the Lord who is in this place with us. Receive now God's blessing. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you, both now and evermore. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.